I'd like to invite some of our presenters. I've asked in advance. We can only have six people on the screen at one time here. And so I've asked some of the presenters to actually join us on camera. And before, as we're starting to get online here, I'd like to make a couple of announcements. And first of all, I'd like to thank the USDA NEPA-funded IPM centers for facilitating this webinar. It would have been very difficult to do it in any other way. And I'd also like to call to your attention a recently published test note from the centers that's available actually on the GoToWebinar control panel. You can download it from there or also at the IPM Center's website. And so feel free to get that. I also want to remind you that we are going to have a link to a very brief survey, and we really appreciate your participation in that survey to let us know how you like the webinar, what additional information you'd like more detail on. And I will follow it up. We'll follow up this with an email to your addresses to let you know where to find recordings of the webinar on YouTube when it's up and in that capacity, and also to also remind you about the online survey. And again, we really appreciate your participation in that. Now, this is an opportunity to submit some questions you might have for our presenters. And we already had a few that came in advance, and Bob Martin's on the screen there. I hate to put Bob on the spot, but I passed along some of the questions to him from Oregon a little bit earlier. And so, Bob, while we're getting everybody online here, do you mind addressing some of those specific questions?
I have to pull them back up, see what they were.
Okay. Should I have a confirming? This is a person in Oregon that had a positive red blotch test and the following questions. Should I have a confirming test this year?
I would definitely get a confirming test before, especially if you're thinking about taking material out. And I think the other thing was they had some older blocks that had been planted in the 80s and 90s without symptoms, and they put a new block in 2008, I believe it was, where they're seeing 2008 or 2000. Yes. Yeah, and now they're seeing symptoms in the older blocks as well. So that would suggest that they have vectors. And again, it depends how widespread it is in the newer blocks or the older blocks, whether or not it's too far along to actually try to eradicate it. If it's a few plants, remove them as soon as possible because you want to get rid of
it. Can be taken to stop the spread of any.
Well, you know, we heard the first information on vectors today. So we don't know anything yet about when that vector is present in the vineyard, et cetera, or if there are other vectors. It's very preliminary. But it's a big step in the right direction. So at this point, I think removal of infected plants, get rid of the inoculum, is the best thing we can do. That's what I would recommend.
So on the, and I don't know if you can see this as well, some of the presenters, but on the right hand, well, with the GoToWebinar control panel, there's several questions, and I'd like to just start addressing those.
Currently only I can see the questions and you can see the questions. We can forward them to them or read them off.
Would you mind reading those off, Joe? I'm having a difficulty getting the whole question on here on my screen.
Sure, not a problem. So our first question is from David Beck. Does the failure to find particles, coproteins, etc., indicate that the virus is more like the T1 plasmid in Agrobacterium? And he later had a follow-up question when Dr. Bader was talking about the coat protein you were talking there. Have they found a coat protein? Have they not found a coat protein? What's going on between Dr. Bader's presentation and Mark's presentation?
Well, I think it was two separate. When I was discussing coat protein, I wasn't looking specifically for the coprotein. I was doing PCR assays, and the coprotein analysis I did was based on sequence data I had downloaded from GeneBank related to the red blotch isolates and clades that are present in North America, and I compared the amino acids, the known amino acid sequence of red blotch versus other Gemini viruses to get an idea of the relationship of red blotch relative to other Gemini viruses within the context of an evolutionary relationship to vectors. And I didn't do any tests strictly with coprotein.
Yeah, that coprotein is in silico. Based on the sequence information, it's the best we have.
Yeah. Okay. Next question was, can you tell whether the red blotch is going from Merlot to the wild vines or from the wild to the Merlot? And I think that was when Keith was talking.
It was Keith, yeah.
Hi, can I make a comment on that? So we found a seedling vine in the surrounding vegetation in that one block in southern Oregon, and that seedling vine must have been less than maybe a year old, and it was found positive. So that does indicate that there is, you know, we don't know about it. It has to be moved by an insect, and most likely, to the best of my understanding, the biggest source of virus is in the vineyard. I'm not aware of such a big source of virus in other vegetation. I may be wrong, but that's what I'm getting from that observation that we made.
Any comments on that?
I think Mark, you're muted, I think.
Okay, I'm back on track here.
Okay.
So based on our work, it is very easy to identify red blotch in free-living vines, at least in Napa Valley. You know, the question is chicken and egg situation. And I think the work that has been done so far precludes any conclusion as to the directional movement either from commercial vineyard to wild and riparian areas or the other way around. There is definitely, you know, some forensics work that, preliminary forensics work that indicates some similarities in the genetic composition of the virus present in commercial vineyards and wild grapes. But again, the work has been very limited, so it is almost impossible at this point in time to make any inference on the directional movement. More work needs to be done.
Okay. Next question we have is from Clayco Skelton. How important is it to clean or sanitize your shears during pruning? Concerns about moving it from one plant to another.
Well, I might take this one if you want to at least get a shot. In general, red blotch or not red blotch, grapevine viruses are not known to be mechanically transmitted in any given vineyard. So basically, pruning, trimming, shearing, harvesting is not known to move any virus from an infected vine to an adjacent clean vine, so from one block to the other. And red blotch seem to fit that bill. This being said, you know, viruses can be moved from vineyard to vineyard, plant to plant, through vectors, as was alluded to in terms of mealybugs and soft scales for leaf roll. And, you know, if Brian is on the right track, you know, the alfalfa tree hopper might be another vector for red blotch.
Okay. We had a question for Vaughn. Eurythonera leafhoppers are mesophyll feeders. We presume that red blotch moves through the phloem. Any evidence for Eurythonera leafhoppers can transmit the red blotch? I think this will be, there are several questions similar to this.
We, you know, if you look at the information coming from all the other labs, it's negative. we're finding waste and grape leafhopper in the majority of all the vineyards where we've been doing that sampling. We were initially thinking that's something that we should be focusing on, but after Brian shared that new information with us, it's clear that we're on the wrong track. So I think we'll definitely, if we get funded, we'll be focusing on some of these other insects that we have samples of, and we'll, first thing is we'll check through what we've collected and work with Brian and Frank and Sudi and other people to see what we're finding here in Oregon. But pretty clear to me that maybe we were on the wrong track here. That's at least my assessment at this stage.
Okay, we have a question for Bob. Was the 1970s block of PN with 36 selections that were infected grafted on the same rootstock?
They were all self-rooted.
Okay.
They were not grafted, so.
In these vineyards showing transmission of red blotch to new plants, which way were the predominant winds? Or does the way the wind blows toward or away from infected areas?
Oh, well, in terms of wind data, I don't have any of that information. The site in Oakville, one thing we did notice was in the eastern corner of the vineyard block was predominantly the clade 1 that Keith talked about in his presentation. And some of the spread that was documented in the western side of the plot, the new infections that we saw were of clade 2, which were previously absent from that vineyard plot. So in terms of actual wind movement and that kind of information, we don't have, but the spread data that we do have is indicative of a flying insect, and with the introduction of the second clade, that's the kind of information we have at this point. And we're gonna follow up with this tree hopper to better understand the biology and movement patterns that it has, and in relation to it doesn't include it. Yeah, and it also, we're not including another vector. It's possible that there's another species. It's too preliminary to make any definitive statements about other species not being affected. Some definitely don't seem likely, but we don't want to definitively say no for things that we're not 100% sure about.
Can I ask a question about the percent or the fraction of those hoppers that you've been finding in those vineyards? I'm just very interested to know what kind of fraction or percentage or numbers you're getting in the field itself.
So far, from my observations, in the actual vineyards, in the grape canopies, they're not terribly abundant. I mentioned that grapes are not the preferred host, and from my work, they don't appear to be a reproductive host for the tree hopper. And the girdling and feeding damage on grapes from the species is incidental, but they do definitely prefer grasses and legumes. And in some of our plots, you can sweep a row of vines and maybe get one or two adults, and then you sweep in the grass immediately adjacent to it, and you can pull in 20 of these things just from a small strip of grass. So actually present on the grapes, they're not very common, but if you look into the edge habitat, they can be quite abundant.
Okay. Sorry, parsing through the questions. There's quite a few of them here. Uh, have the Canadian Vitis vinifera been sourced primarily from Europe or from the U.S.?
Boy, that's... I don't know if Sudarsana is still on, where you can get on the microphone and answer that. Sudarsana, if you're there. Yes. Can you address that?
Yes. That most of the Canadian grape wine is sourced from Europe, but it's only recently we see a transition from, you know, planting material coming from America, U.S. as well. But, you know, I think it's 90% of BC grapevine material was sourcing from Europe.
Thank you for being there and turning on your microphone to answer that question.
You're welcome.
Joe, do you have another one?
Yeah, I'm trying to work through them. Sorry about that.
Can I ask a question while we wait to Brian again?
Sure.
Brian, are you finding any other leafhoppers? You did mention Membrassidae. Are you finding any other Membrassidae that you're kind of wary about in some of those vineyards?
Not Membrassid. The only other Membrassid I've seen out at Oakville was, I believe it's feeding on oak trees, and I have seen it on sticky traps in the riparian edge habitats, but I have never found it in the vineyards, either on the grapes or between the rows, and I don't really have any reason to believe that it is also a vector. It, you know, when I tested it, it didn't test positive for red blotch. That being said, there are, it's a fairly diverse group, so there could be more uncommon species that are out there that I haven't seen yet, and you know, that's why we want to keep following up with some of the other species that seem to be prevalent in vineyards with spread and absent versus vineyards without spread, but you know, we want to keep looking at some of these other species just in case. We don't want to just throw in the towel.
I think I mentioned to you that the ones we've been concentrating on more recently have been the ones where we've seen consistently in every vineyard that we suspected spread. And also ones where, when we field collect them, that they are have a fairly high proportion of them that test positive for the virus also. And the Membrassid was one of those, and there's a few other species yet. But we haven't seen them express in the plant yet, but we've got a number of those plants inoculated, and we're looking still.
We've got a couple questions related to testing for it. Is there a best time to test for red blotch? Can you take samples for it now? And what part of the plants have the highest titer?
I mean, there's several people who could answer that one. So...
Sorry, I missed that. I don't know what.
can I just comment on that? This is Sudarshan from Canada.
Sure.
Yes,
go
please.
Ahead.
Okay, so with the testings, we kind of did a preliminary work on what plant material and what season. But in our observation, probably just like last one season, we detected the virus from hardwood in the winters as well as green leaf tissue throughout the season. But this year we are trying to see that particular time where the virus concentration is more using more sophisticated and sensitive techniques like droplet digital PCR, which can quantify. That's one of our objective. Hopefully, we will come up with an answer, and hopefully some other will also comment on this.
Yeah, we've done testing in the dormant season as well as the summer. I prefer mid to late summer because we normally always test for leaf roll as well. That's why I want to have optimal timing for the leaf roll. But mid-summer into fall, but you know, even in the dormant season, if you do bark scrapings, is what we do.
I agree with Bob. If it's old wood, you can detect it any time. But if it's a new growth, you can have a miss early in the season. After a month of once the bud break happens, it's possible to detect in the new growth too.
I just have a question. I think it was Mark who made Mark or someone else who made a comment. I can't remember who made the comment, but in some years you'd find that the vines are testing positive and then following years they test negative. Does anyone know why we're finding that?
I can answer that. We have had wines tested in Oakville, which was cleaned several years. And suddenly, actually, we had tested one time early in the season too, and those shoots had been negative. But during the middle of the season, probably the vector hit the virus, put the virus there, and those shoots came positive. And once it's pruned off, maybe the inoculum is gone. And next year, we had a miss sometimes like that.
We have a question of what other host plants are there besides wild grape for this particular disease?
Frank, excuse me, but I have another appointment I have to go to. So,
well, that's great, Deborah. I appreciate you being with me today, really. Yeah, that was
fantastic. Putting this together.
Take care.
Take care.
Daniel, do you recall the list of the species we tested?
Not everyone on the list, okay. But I think...
you can say all negative. Okay, what we tested.
Yeah, we tested, some of the oak trees, a lot of the grasses around the vineyards, blackberries, wild grapes, and I think our the only plant that seems to be a true host is our wild grapes, and the results there are pretty consistent, I think, with Mark's and Keith's, where they were pretty easy to find red blotch in wild grapes, but in terms of other plants, we haven't seen it in anything else. I don't know if that's different for Mark or Keith, but from our surveys, we haven't seen anything else.
We've tested a lot. Go ahead.
I just concur with Brian and Sudi's assessment. We have the same type of results. We haven't found red blotch outside of Vitis specimens.
Yeah, we've tested a lot of blackberries adjacent to vineyards that have red blotch, and they've all been negative.
Yeah, when we detected red blotch in the blackberries, we followed up with the same plants throughout the year, and the ones that we were able to get sequences from ended up being negative later in the year, and when we tested for RNA to see if it was replicating, they came up negative. So what I think may have been happening is with the vector being present, it was using it as an alternate host, and it maybe either deprecated or injected it into the feeding wound, but because it wasn't a host, the virus didn't become systemic, and it was merely a environmental contaminant that we were detecting. So something that, it's there, but it's not a true host for the virus, whereas the Vitis seemed to be an actual host.
Question for Sudi. How consistent are the symptoms in each variety? Are the different patterns of symptoms seen in your pictures typical for the varieties?
I think it's pretty typical for those varieties. Only Cabernet Sauvignon, in some years it can be mild, in some years you can see a little stronger symptoms. I think year after year there could be a little variation, but they're pretty consistent. A striking feature is about the Pinot Noir. It always comes like that.
I'm going to have to take off for another meeting. So thank you all for putting this together. Thank you. It was great.
I know this is going on a long time, but we have quite a few questions, and as long as any presenters can be here, really appreciate you being here.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, I have another meeting at once. I'm going to have to sign off. But thank you very much.
Just to add up to Sudi's comments, in my personal experience, and say Keith Perry's experience as well, we don't know what a typical leaf roll or a typical red blotch symptom is all about. Unless we come across, you know, textbook type of typical symptoms, more than 90% of the time I will not rely on the visual inspection to decide whether we are dealing with red blotch or leaf roll. Because to me, very often there is some confusion there, and there is so close similarities between the two types of symptoms that I will not declare one way or the other any longer.
Okay. So we have
That we looked at this one vineyard. You saw the map of that one vineyard in the Willamette Valley. And just kind of reiterating what Mark was saying, it's extremely important that the vines are tested. That vineyard didn't have any mealybugs. We didn't see any spread of the leaf roll virus there. So if you know what the virus is, then, you know, if you know it's leaf roll, then maybe be less worried, at least in that one situation. Whereas with red blotch, if you know it's red blotch, then and you know you've got maybe some of these new vectors, or these vectors that we now know are potentially around, then that's something that could potentially help direct what you're doing.
The one problem might be is I'm a little bit kind of biased with North Coast vineyards in Napa, where the vineyards I have visited mostly didn't have any leaf roll, so. It's only red blotch what I have, you know, when growers told me they only have red blotch, so that's when I have tried to look at it. So, you know, when you have mixed infections, a lot of times, you know, I have seen in a couple of cases where the symptoms can vary, you know, year to year also, it could be a bit different, you know. So, Mark has seen more of leaf roll and red blotch everything, so, compared to me.
Well, I think Rhonda mentioned that as well with the red blotch, that the symptoms, you know, they seem to be more prominent in some years than others, too.
We have a question about roguing infected vines and replanting. Is there any evidence of transmission through soil or transmission within the vine in the case of field grafting?
I can answer that. No, there is no transmission from any of the soil. We were at the block, the first block I went there, it was in 2008, and that block was heavily having too much of red blotch incidence. So they pulled it out 2 years later and replanted in 2011. And we have been monitoring from 2011 onwards in that block. There is no evidence to say there was a soil-borne source of inoculum in that vineyard. Actually, some of the plants that showed up positive, you know, they came positive by PCR, they were all pulled out, about 17 vines out of 600. And a year later, we didn't see any new infection. And of course, last year, we saw some new infections, that was only three, and they were not in the same area. So this block is right close to the older vineyard, so whatever is happening is it's not happening from the soil. Mark, do you have anything to say, Anne?
No, I concur with your assessment. I do not believe at this point in time, based on my personal observation, that even if you uproot an infected vine and replant a clean vine, that this clean vine might get infected through root grafting or any other means or any potential soil-borne vector. as has been hypothesized, you know, a few years ago.
Would anyone care to address virus latency and whether symptoms can come and go?
Definitely, this is very common, actually. Because symptom expression, keep in mind, symptom expression is a result of an interaction between a given virus genotype or a virus variant or virus strain with a given cultivar clone on a rootstock in a given environment. So you have, you know, hundreds, if not zillions, of factors that will influence this type of interaction. So that symptom severity or even symptom type vary from year to year, season to season, is very common.
Okay. People have been asking a whole lot about the vector. They first of all, can you repeat the name of the vector that you managed to get to work?
The common name is the three-cornered alfalfa hopper. The scientific name is Spicistolus festinus.
Okay.
And it's a native species to North America. It's mostly common in the southeast of the U.S., where it's a big pest of soybean, peanuts, and other legumes, and it's more prevalent in the south with populations. They exist up into Canada, but the numbers are not nearly what they are in the warmer regions of North America.
Is that the same as Cereza festina?
I'm sorry?
Cereza festina, C-E-R-E-S-A. F-E-S-T-I-N-A?
That is a very mysterious name for me. I've seen it in a few instances, but I cannot locate the taxonomic work that it may be the original description for that
species.
It is. Yeah, and I think it's, you know, tomato or tomato. It's doesn't change the bug, but it's the same species they're referring to, so...
Adding to Brian, the alfalfa hopper, I think it is pretty much listed in almost all grape pest books as something like girdling insect, right? No?
The only reference I know of it in grapes is Rhonda's.
Okay. IPM.
Work on it from, I think the reference was from 1999 in one of the pest management, and it doesn't seem a serious of grapes due to girdling. It was just a kind of incidental occurrence. It didn't severely impact it.
You know, it's really not uncommon. I mean, you find it in vineyards, but it's not in the vineyards throughout the year. It seems like it, at least on the vines.
Yeah. My idea with, you know, later in the season, you see a lot more girdling. And with the weather patterns here in California, what I suspect is, you know, in the winter and the spring when it's cooler and a little wetter, there's lots of grass growing, lots of food source for it. And then once you hit the summer and the dry months, everything dries up and gets cut. So its preferred host is no longer there. So then it starts feeding more commonly on the wine grapes. And that's when you see an increase in girdling. And if it's, you know, a vector in the field, that's going to cause a, you know, that's likely going to be when the spread is going to be happening.
I just saw an email from Rick Hilton where he said that they found that the three-cornered alfalfa hopper in the 2003 Oregon Viticulture Handbook. So apparently it's been around here, so we'll have to check for it.
Yeah.
Just to add to the distribution and to what Brian said, I fully concur. You know, in the East Coast, it is not known to occur in grapes, or it has. You know, it's a very rare occasion if one even finds it in grasses or other hosts. And we do not have any evidence that red blotch is moving on the East Coast, from vine to vine or vineyard to vineyard.
We see that trend internationally as well. It's if it's a native to North America, it
kind of fits that bill. And, you know, the history of invasive species, that could always change. But you never know.
Well, and there is a question of, are these attracted to yellow sticky traps? Looks like someone's looking to do some scouting.
I can say from what I've done so far that that is a very inefficient way of looking for them. You will find them from time to time by chance, but
I'll address that one. I actually have a graduate student that's working on erythra neurozigzag, and she's working in untreated vineyards, so we have really high populations of erythra neuro, and she's running yellow sticky traps in there, and in there we are picking up more of the alfalfa helpers, but it picks it up when the densities are rather high. Otherwise, it's just occasional. And the Oakville Station, for example, they treat the vineyard there, and so the populations are really low, except I think in the grasses and things, you know, and adjacent to the vineyard. But in an untreated vineyard where the populations of the alfalfa hopper get higher later in the year, you can pick it up on there.
If you want to really see the population and how it changes, I would say the more efficient way is sweeping in the alternate host plants throughout the year to get an idea of its true numbers, because if you're putting sticky traps in the canopies, if it's treated even like a normal vineyard, it may not be a terribly informative way to evaluate the populations.
Well, and then that's bringing another set of questions, which is, are cover crops a concern? Are there best cover crops? If this really is a vector, then what do we have to look at for what's being planted there?
This is going to open up a whole area of research for people at this point. I really can't tell you anything about that. So, I mean, looking at other hosts of the brassid, when it would be moving from those homes and become present in the grapes, I mean, all that's things that we're going to be having to look at pretty intensively this year. We really haven't specifically been looking at its biology in vineyards previously. Vaughn, maybe you have some ideas on that.
I was just going to make a comment, which is never a safe thing to do. Before I'm making the comment, I was just going to say, so Brian, you're saying we should just do clean cultivation then, right? I don't know. It's just a comment.
You know, I was back in the early 90s. I worked a lot on cover crops and grapes, you know, with legume and grass cover crops. And, you know, we were concerned at that point about leafhopper, you know, as a source potentially of leafhoppers in the vineyards. But we really didn't think about any other types of insects. And I honestly can't say if there's any relation there. I would just say, though, like Brian said, that there's so many potential hosts around the vineyards and
highly polyphagous species,
so I'm not sure that it's going to increase the populations that much within a vineyard, but I think that's just open for question.
I would say, from what I've seen on campus here, as long as you're not putting lots of alfalfa between the grapes, they love that, so the populations would explode if that were the case.
No alfalfa. So we at least know we don't want to be planting alfalfa between our grapes.
I would say at least.
But they're really prolific, Juan. I mean, they're on grasses as well. Around the vineyard, then they move in.
So we did those sweep samples, and I think we've done this for several years now, and we found a much, much wider range of insects on those compared to the sticky traps. So it looks as if the sweep samples, or maybe thinking of placing our sticky traps in a different spot, lower down, might be a good idea as well, in addition to the sweep samples. So I think that's something that we definitely would have to look at. Try and see what the population dynamics look like. I don't know. What are your thoughts about that?
I would think, you know, if you were monitoring, to have a sticky trap
very low to the ground, one up in the canopy, and then sweep alongside with that. And I think that would give you a pretty nice understanding of what's there and when.
We're going to be doing virtually that this year. We've already talked about what the next steps are, you know. And we have been monitoring sticky cards near the bed and up in the canopy, along with Cindy's leafhopper studies, since, you know, but we just have not been specifically looking for them or grass it, other than we've picked it and seen it. Now we'll be specifically looking for that, too.
So has the disease been found in the southeast, in the Georgia area?
Yes.
Okay. Isn't anthracycline production in leaves a general stress response often seen in response to viral promoter activity?
I can't specifically answer that, but I'd say that in alfalfa, because we have the hopper in alfalfa, and we see the same symptoms in alfalfa where the above the feeding wound that the alfalfa leaves turn red. So I'm not sure it has anything to do with the virus. Maybe Marker could help with that, or Sudhi.
I don't know. I just thought it's a general stress response. I'm not even sure. I'm not a great physiologist, so I can't.
Yeah, and that would be my thought, too, is that since you're seeing the same kind of plant response to the feeding in alfalfa, you know, it's probably more of a stress response in the grapes as well.
Well, what, you know, this is just speculation, but what I think is happening in the grapes is the girdling that occurs and, you know, the individual leaves turn red. But in the lab on my source plants and recipient plants, when they girdle, those leaves don't turn red. And I know that when they're girdling, they're producing a nutrient sink, and they sit there and they feed on all the photosynthetics. And I suspect that that increase in red in the grape leaves only happens after veraison, when the plant's starting to naturally produce anthocyanins to put into the berry cells. And because it's blocked, it's accumulated.
This is where we need a plant physiologist. And
that's just my guess.
And there is a question about whether or not the red blotch affects grape quality components other than sugars and acids.
I think there are some studies that are underway to, you know, pinpoint as to what the effect is on quality. And I think there are some quite interesting data indicating that the level of malic acid, and I forgot a few other key components of quality, are definitely altered by red blotch. You know, in addition to the anthocyanin content of berry skins and the sugar levels and so forth. So yes, quality is highly affected. At least I'm aware of a number of studies in focusing on Cabernet Sauvignon and Cabernet Franc.
I kind of wish Anita was on the webinar today, because she might be able to help address some of that. Unfortunately, she couldn't be with us.
How long does it take for grapevine red blotch virus to become systemic within the vine? In other words, how long does it take to become detectable in other parts of the vine after the vector transmits the virus into the vine, one shoot?
Well, from the data set I have with the digital PCR, I was testing new growth leaves because I allowed the insects to feed freely on the vines. I didn't want to just expose them to an individual leaf at a risk of the girdling blocking the virus into the recipient leaf. But from testing new growth with the digital PCR, I started detecting it at 3 months, but that was a group of 15 plants. Now, I don't know if I had tested each plant individually by digital PCR, if I could detect it sooner or not. But from my experiments, I was picking it up at 3 months with digital PCR, and then just starting to pick it up with standard at 5 months.
Are there climatic conditions that promote the symptom expression of red blotch?
Mark, do you have any idea on that?
More or less, again, you know, informed by some very limited personal experience, I would say my understanding is that, you know, coolish, wet springs might trigger symptoms earlier than an average, you know, growing season, whatever average, you know, means, or higher elevation vineyards versus, you know, down the valley vineyards might express earlier symptoms than down in the valley. But, you know, that's just anecdotal more than truly informed.
I think that's as good as anybody, though, Mark. You have such experience as anybody. That's a good answer.
You're very kind, Frank.
Well, and there's also a question then about temperature and climate in affecting the spread of red blotch, not just symptom development.
That's going to be relative to how the climate affects vector populations, not just in development, but, you know, we don't know what kind of natural enemies, parasitoids, could be impacted.
Well, and how it's affecting its natural host, too, where it's building up in the environment.
There's a question about how many times your greenhouse transmission experiment repeated.
From the cohort that I presented, that involved 15 replications. So I had done 15 experiments where I moved an individual tree hopper from the source plant onto a recipient plant. So I did 15 transmission assays with exposure to the virus, and I had done 5 control assays where I brought the tree hopper from an alfalfa plot on campus and treated that as a negative control and exposed those. All those are negative along the same time period, and of the 15 transmission assays, it was 3 out of 15 that were successful. I have done other assays with the other insects, as well as with the tree hopper, where I brought them directly from infected vineyards and placed them on recipient plants. And we're coming up on the 5-month test with those to see how many of those are infected. But from the group of plants that we've confirmed and we have the furthest and most data on, it was 15 replications.
Okay, and they're saying how many times you repeated the entire actual experiment, you're saying 15 replications.
Well, I have 2 other groups of 15 that I am still testing, and we're still generating data on those for getting the paper ready, but right now what I was presenting was a group of 15 replications, and I have a few other groups of 15 replications with the same species that I'm working on getting data for.
Okay.
Brian, can I ask you how many, I'm sure you said that, but I didn't make a note on that, how many of those hoppers you had in each of those 15 reps?
It was an individual insect.
Wow. One individual insect in each of the 15.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So you don't need a lot then. You need one, and that's it.
And you know, and in the vineyards, well, you don't see a lot feeding on the grapes. it's not a species that you hit them and it's a cloud of them. If that were the case, I would say maybe I'll do the experiments with big groups, but from what I see in the populations, they're not common enough on the grapes. You know, if they are spreading it in the field, it's likely one individual. And the reality is they probably don't need 48 hours to acquire or transmit the virus, because they're not, you know, they're landing on these grapes, they're feeding on them because they're there, but they're not hanging out for a long period of time.
Ron, this is actually pretty representative of what you see in the field, you know, because the numbers are so low. And
on top of that, when I started these, I didn't have a big colony, so I was kind of restricted in the numbers I could use. So I figured instead of doing one with 15 individuals, I would rather do 15 individual assays, you know, more for statistical reasons.
Is there any information on how a vigorous nutritional program would affect the symptoms of red blotch, and which nutrients in particular can help minimize the symptoms of it?
I have had some vineyard managers, they thought they could ameliorate the symptoms by putting potash, and it did not help. And somebody else thought it could be zinc deficiency, and they tried to do that. It did not help. For all I know, Dr. David Smart at University of California, Davis, in the viticulture and enology department, he's running projects to see whether nutritional amendments can ameliorate the symptoms or not at this stage. I don't know if anything has been found that can help the plants or not.
Okay. Brian, I'm going to ask you if you wouldn't mind looking on Frank's control panel for questions. There's quite a few vector questions in the queue. You've answered quite a few of those. If you would mark those as being answered, I'll pull up the next question, and that'll help me process some of these. So the next question, Mark, can you clarify the method that was used for successful infecting of clean vines?
Can you just repeat? Sorry, I was the method used to produce clean vines.
The method that was successful for infecting clean vines.
Oh. Infecting. Okay. So basically, what we have done was to isolate the virus from infected vines, and moving the virus in a lab setting, obviously, into one of the causal agents of Crohn's gall disease, a bacterium called Agrobacterium tumefaciens. This bacterium, when we insert, and this is done very routinely in laboratories involved in biotech type of work, this bacterium is naturally designed, when it induces Crohn's gall and causes tumors on grapes, to transfer some of its genetic elements into the grape chromosomes. So we basically take advantage of what Mother Nature has developed through Agrobacterium tumefaciens and introduce the virus genome into the bacterium and use the bacterium to transfer the virus into the grape genome. And after the bacterium infects the grape, the virus will start multiplying and infesting systemically the grapevine. And this is the systemic infection that we monitor over time, and we maintain the plants in the greenhouse, and expose them to two consecutive dormancies before we generated the data that I presented, and put us in a position to conclusively determine that red blotch associated virus is the causal agent of the disease. Hope this clarifies the methodology that we have used.
Okay. All right, so we have a comment that they've seen red blotch in Virginia, and has anyone looked at free-growing wild vines there? Also, have they looked at cane girdlers or cane gall makers as potential vectors?
I know that red blotch has been indeed found in Virginia. That's the work by Nizo and Nita and his team. They did a fantastic work on surveying some of the vineyards and described the presence of red blotch. I don't recall off the top of my head, and I feel really bad to report for them, whether they surveyed, you know, wild grapes or riparian areas or checked for vectors of red blotch. I just don't recall. And I would hate to misrepresent their work.
Are there more uncharacterized vine viruses? If so, does anyone have an estimate of the number of mystery viruses that are out there?
We still have that Wantanar necrotic union problem. You know, the Pinot Noir, some of the clothes which have probably a latent virus. Three times we have done deep sequencing, we haven't found any answer yet. And it's quite likely there will be others. I think it all depends on when a grower or somebody would notice and report to somebody so that it can come to the attention of a researcher. So I think there might be more viruses, we don't know yet. Because in Brazil, they have recently they reported another DNA virus, which according to them infects grapes, pear, and apple. Even in China, they reported another DNA virus. So there might be more viruses, we don't know yet.
Just to add to that comment, when you just make the simple analysis of what we currently know in terms of viruses associated to any given disease, when you think about leaf roll, we know of five viruses that are associated with leaf roll. For fan leaf, we know at least 15 or 16 different viruses that can cause fan leaf. For red blotch, so far we know of one virus. So to me, even for red blotch, it doesn't take a stretch of an imagination that maybe there are other virus species out there that are potentially associated with red blotch that we don't know of.
Okay. With the reddening of the veins, they don't always phrase the question clearly. Would the reddening of the veins be the relocation of anthocyanin's biosynthesis from the berries, skins, to the veins? So what's causing the reddening of the veins, I think, is what they're aiming at.
I don't know the answer.
If removing a vineyard with red blotch is not an option, are there any vineyard practices known to increase Brix on infected vineyards?
Rhonda's presentation was pretty clear. Even if you deal with reducing a crop load, you won't gain any benefits. So there might be other solutions out there that I'm not aware of. But I don't have any personally I have no recommendation.
Okay. Let's see. Since there is evidence of difference in severity of symptoms, do you feel there's maybe a result in severity of impact on quality?
We have a little collaborative project with Lynn Wunderlich in Foothills. Lynn has looked at Zinfandel, and there appears to be a tremendous effect on Zinfandel. Lynn, with your permission, I'm talking about it. Maybe Frank, I don't know whether you have more to add in onto this.
Well, you could see you could even see the difference in color in the juice.
Yes.
From the symptom. And you've probably seen that also, Mark, from the juice on red varieties. So. Even the colors.
Okay. It seems that red blotch has been with us for many decades, but it seems that in recent years we are seeing it affect vineyard performance in a dramatic way. Is red blotch becoming more virulent, and if so, why? Or perhaps is it combining with other viruses or pathogen and making it more of an issue for us?
Okay. I would say that it's not because it became virulent. It was simply ignored under the leaf roll umbrella, that's all.
Okay. Someone thanks Brian's for the great work. Do you or anyone study mealybugs, sorry, as a potential vector?
Yeah, I've done a lot of assays with mealybugs, and I have detected red blotch in mealybugs, and it's I attribute that to them being highly efficient phloem feeders. And with red blotch likely being a phloem-limited virus, getting high concentrations of red blotch in the gut of a mealybug is not a big surprise. But I've done transmission assays with citrus mealybug, long tail, obscure. I even tried subterranean mealybugs, and none of them have transmitted red blotch.
We had a question on has.
Did you do grape mealybug also?
No, I haven't. I haven't done grape mealybug.
I think Brian pretty much looked at the whatever he could find in Oakville Station primarily.
So if we look at the distribution of the grape mealybug and then the. And I know this is not proving Koch's postulate, but we're not seeing a correlation between the mealybug infestation patterns and the red blotch infestation patterns.
Well, you know, we were looking at, because it was, because of them being phloem feeders, we looked at them pretty extensively initially, and looking at your data, Vaughn, from the distribution of red blotch in infected vineyards and distribution of leaf roll in the same vineyards, it would really seem to suggest it's not something that moves like a mealybug would move. So I think we sort of backed off a little bit on that too.
And that going along with what Mark and Keith have found with, you know, finding the virus in wild grapes, sometimes a substantial distance from vineyards, you know, there's got to be a mechanism for movement between a wild grape and a cultivated. And some of these distances, mealybugs or some of these slow-moving insects just aren't going to cut it. You know, whereas leafhoppers or trappers are fairly decent flyers. So.
Yeah, we've been able to detect the virus in wild grapevines that were, you know, a long way away from any commercial vineyards.
And that's not knowing the status of the vineyard. Red blotch, that was just the nearest.
Just the nearest vineyard.
And also I think we have heard in one vineyard in Napa where leaf roll and red blotch are crossing paths, so intercrossing. So that obviously says the mealybugs are not vectors of red blotch.
Has anyone tested breeding program seedlings for red blotch?
Not to my knowledge. It's one of these days we might probably do a few things with Dr. Andy Parker, but we don't have any project set on that.
Well, I'm not sure I fully grasp the question. If the question is red blotch potentially infecting grapes derived from seedlings, the answer is yes. Whether the question was, you know, is there any program, breeding program for resistance, I'm not aware of.
I think they were asking if in the breeding programs they were testing for red blotch.
I'm not aware of any breeding program that is focusing on red blotch resistance.
How effective is shoot tip therapy in eliminating red blotch? Unfortunately, I think Deborah has left, so does anyone else want to weigh in on that?
Based on our experience here at Cornell, it is effective at eliminating red blotch, but red blotch is less efficiently eliminated compared to leaf-roll viruses, for example, in our hands, or fan leaf, using the same technology. So just reemphasizing the fact that red blotch behaves very differently than any other grape virus that is known. But it is possible to eliminate it.
Okay. Someone has clarification. Were they correct in hearing that the virus is not documented to move from vineyard to vineyard in the East?
That is based on my personal observations and cross-checking data from other colleagues, yes.
Okay. And then they follow up, why do you think that is if the vector is present here?
Well, I didn't say that the vector was present on the East Coast. If the hypothesis is that the three-cornered alfalfa hopper is the vector, I said, if this is the vector, it is a very rare occurrence that we find it even in his preferred hosts on the East Coast. So long to say that in vineyards, it is not even known to occur.
So there's a question about what's the distribution of tree hoppers in California, and would this follow the distribution of red blotch in the Central Valley, and what the occurrence is of red blotch in the Central Valley on grapes, including raisin and table grapes.
Well, since we're just starting to look at this tree hopper as the vector and take it kind of seriously, there's only been really one study, to my knowledge, on this tree hopper in California. Ken Bain's group was looking at it a few years back when they were evaluating sharpshooters for transmitting Pierce's disease, and they were incidentally finding a lot of these tree hoppers. So they tested them as a potential vector for Pierce's disease. And they have some phenology data, but other than that, this species hasn't really been studied in California.
Well, in grapes.
In grapes.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just looking at my other computer here, and people are sending me emails too, and might be the same person. What's the distribution of tree hoppers in California? They're really in the Central Valley and other places. They're pretty widespread. We have a lot of alfalfa that's grown. They're common in the Central Valley. They're very common in Southern California, common in a lot of the coastal areas. But from knowledge on other hosts like alfalfa, and what their distribution is on grapes, we're really not sure. It's one of those things that could this follow the distribution of grapevine red blotch in the Central Valley? Really pretty unknown. I mean, we really haven't been able to survey all the grape vineyards in California. We've never had an opportunity to do anything like that. But we believe grapevine red blotch associated virus is in the Central Valley. Sudhi might comment on this. We've seen a few vineyards where people have asked us to look at that. We've been able to determine that it's there. What the association with the alfalfa hopper, I mean, at that moment, we were not even thinking about alfalfa hopper in relation to grapes. But certainly there are a lot of the insect in the Central Valley here. So this question was pretty much a Central Valley question. On raisin and table grapes, I mean, I'm sure that the alfalfa hopper is located in all the areas with raisin table grapes. There's so much alfalfa around in that area. Whether the virus is present or not, Sudhi, I know maybe you can comment on that.
Well,
information.
There was only one instance when somebody approached me. This was in 2012. That was near Fresno County. But other than that was from a wine grape vineyard, not from any table grapes or others. So I never heard anybody having a red blotch issue with table grapes or raisins. And even in the Fresno County vineyard, when I looked around, it was very hard to say whether it was a gradient or not, because a lot of wines were infected at that point.
Okay, we have a question. I think you guys have answered this one already, but one more. Has anyone seen anything that can mediate the effects of the virus on sugar accumulation? Foliar nutrients, anything that can bring the bricks up?
The only thing they have been doing so far is delayed harvest, nothing else.
Okay. So, Brian, for the results you presented on tree hopper greenhouse transmission, it's very exciting, obviously. Were you able to visually see symptoms after 4 months, or was it only detected with the digital chip PCR low titer? And can you describe the next steps need to look at field transmission?
Short answer is yes. Two of the three plants that tested positive, they weren't strong symptoms all over the plants, but there were a few leaves that began showing some red blotches and red veins. But it's still, I don't believe, by standard PCR, the reactions were faint relative to our source plant. So I believe that the titer is still increasing in the plant, and over time we're going to see more prominent symptoms. But we did start seeing some symptoms on two of the three plants.
Yeah, I confirm that with Brian because we have them in insect-proof cages, and then when we found that they were starting to show the virus, if you look close, you could start seeing the little reddening on the veins and like that. So the symptoms showed right about the time we first started picking up the virus.
In terms of the field transmission, we do have some experiments in line. We have a new plot that we just set up that we're going to put some infected vines out, and I just got some alfalfa seedlings. They're growing in the greenhouse, and once my colony is up to a reasonable number, we're going to release the beast, so to.
Ryan, can I ask a question? I think it was either you or Frank that made the comment that you found some vineyards where you didn't see the spread of the red blotch. Are there any clear anything kind of just initially clear to you that's different between the vineyards where you're not seeing the spread with this new information that you have now? Different plants, different alternate hosts, maybe that type of stuff?
I can comment on this.
One of the plots that we do not see, we don't suspect spread, the infections are limited to the first two rows, was an increased block where there's virtually nothing around them. And there are, from my survey work there, I never found the tree hopper, and that site was loaded with Virginia creeper and Western grape leaf hopper. And I would suspect that even an inefficient vector with the numbers we saw there, you would expect to see some increase in incidence. I'd have to check my notes, but I know off the top of my head that at both sites where we don't suspect spread, I didn't see girdling on any of the leaves. Just an observation. You know, I need to follow up and look more at our one site in Amador County this past year. Vines that were asymptomatic and tested positive for, or excuse me, tested negative. We went through and mapped those vines that had girdling and no symptoms, and we're going to follow up this year to see if those plants start showing symptoms and testing positive to kind of correlate, you know, the feeding damage in the field to help demonstrate that it's transmitting under field conditions.
Yeah, and I don't know if Lynn's on the webinar here, but I want to thank her for pointing out that site for us, because I think that's going to be a valuable place to be working to.
Because we're finding the vineyards where we're not seeing the spread of red blotch, and I may stand corrected, but Danny maybe has a better idea of that data, but this is on the east, in eastern Oregon, where there are very little alternate hosts, and we're not seeing, I think there were a few vines that had the virus in it, and we hadn't seen any evidence of spread to the best of my knowledge. So that seems to fit in with those observations you just made.
Okay. In my experience so far in the last 6 years, when we started seeing the red blotch, one factor that's common is it's usually the riparian area or reservoirs, irrigation ponds in the vineyards. Usually the incidence is close. No, the disease incidence is more close to that, that kind of area and water holes, and then kind of gradually tapers down. That's when we were always wondering whether there was some insect, some kind of something involved, which would thrive during the off season close to the reservoir and then come back to grapes in the spring season or whenever the grapes start, that was just a hypothesis that was thrown at the time, and by and large, it is still holding good. You know, we see the gradient happening right close to the riparian area and our water holes.
So this farm that both Sudi and Mark was visiting earlier or late last year, and there are some vineyards in there where the vineyard that I showed was the one, of course, where we saw the spread. But there was another vineyard or another block just a little bit away from that, where I think Mark did some testing for virus. And I don't think we saw any spread there, so it'd be good to see. And these are not very far apart from each other, so it'd be good to see. We've not collected insects from there, but just those landscape scale factors might be really important. So we'll have to just look into that.
So, if three-cornered alfalfa hopper is indeed the vector for red blotch, would the manner of transmission likely be semi-persistent or persistent? And what would the implications be for control?
I'd say persistent, given that most of the Gemini viruses are. And, you know, we have some data detecting the virus in hemolymph and salivary glands of the tree hopper.
Yeah, we're actually trying to put together a paper on that right now also, which would suggest that it's present in the hemolymph, and it is.
Yeah.
And so that would suggest it's persistent as well. And,
okay. And in terms of management disease, I imagine it makes it trickier because the insect can retain the virus for much longer, essentially traveling greater distances and still being able to infect.
And a comment, I think someone else made another comment where if you have, like last year, we've had very, very dry conditions, so it could be that what happened is that any of these alternate hosts may have dried out. And, you know, those tree hoppers might have moved, forced to be moved onto grapevines. So hopefully we won't have drought next year or this year, but those are that must play a role.
I think it does.
There's a follow-up question on something Vaughn was looking at with his seedlings, and I think Mark may have already answered it. The seedling you mentioned contained red blotch. This person found red blotch in grape seeds. Is it possible that you can have positive seedlings from positive seed?
We have tested two. We can detect the seed, the virus in the seed. The virus can be present on the seed coat, but there won't be anything in the embryo. So there's no seedling infection that can happen with the virus.
Okay.
So that means it had to be infected after it started growing?
Okay, we're getting to the end of the list of questions. Two left. Is it possible?
4 hours.
Yeah. Is it possible that a leafhopper, specifically Western grape leafhopper, could be a very ineffective vector, but might be effective at large numbers if present in some vineyards?
I'd have to say no.
Well, what I would say is it's impossible to prove a negative, and so we can't prove that it's not a vector with the information that we have. But we have, just circumstantially, we have vineyards that have just huge numbers there and that we have seen no evidence of spread. And so I'm pretty much dismissing that as a possibility, but you can't really prove a negative.
And if it was a vector, you would, if it was inefficient, you would see similar rates of spread consistently wherever this species is present. And all over the West Coast, and we're seeing highly variable cases of increase in virus from place to place, even on the West Coast. That doesn't really fit with it being a vector.
Mark, I don't know if you have any comments on that, but you've seen a lot of vineyards now, too.
I agree entirely with your comments.
So what if we compare those two areas that I showed in the slides earlier, what Brian said does hold true, because we found, and I'd have to go and have a look at the seasonal means of Western grape leafhopper, but it was maybe 100 times less in terms of Western grape leafhopper in the Willamette Valley. We were seeing a doubling of vines that had virus in it. What we need to do is we need to go back and look into the other leafhoppers. We've got all the species and we still have some of those samples. So I think I agree. I was just so curious, and I'm so excited to hear about these findings from your lab, and this really puts us in a position where we can really start looking into it a lot more focused. So, congratulations.
One of the previous questions was, now that we found a vector, I think, and there may still be something else out there. We're not even excluding some of the vines that are already inoculated, because there's some suspicious things, you know. But I think that's I feel comfortable with what we have right now.
Is, you know, from even looking at the co-protein and the how closely related, you know, it's more closely related to another Gemini virus vectored by a member acid, but it's also kind of appears to be straddling that boundary where it could be close to other ones where they see other taxa, you know, maybe a white fly or a leaf popper that could also vector. It's you know, we don't have enough data to
say that. We just don't have data on that. So.
So I know I talked to Brian, was it maybe a year and a half ago, and you were saying maybe it's you were thinking at that stage it was a white fly, or possibly something like white flies, and we really started looking into white fly presence in our vineyards here, and we just did not see that. That was the other question, is we're finding aphids in our vineyards. What are the chances of it being aphids?
Mark's shaking his head, and we're shaking our head.
Yeah, I don't think it's terribly likely.
This is a monopartite genome. I still call it a Gemini virus. No, it's close. There's only one monopartite Gemini virus transmitted by white flies, and that's tomato yellow leaf curl virus. The second one that's known now is citrus chlorotic dwarf virus. It's Parabimicia species. It's a different one. White flies are not that common with monopartite, and this did not fit the profile. Brian checked we white flies and everything that was possible, whatever we could find.
We looked at a number of white flies, you know, in vineyards and tried to do transmission work and haven't come up with anything, but we sort of stopped with that.
Once we started seeing more vineyards and I was able to get an idea of what insects were present, that's really when I was able to, not conclusively say that certain species were not vectors, but start to focus more on the common denominators.
Okay, you've all been amazing troopers, and you've made it through the questions. Thank you all very much for all your participation in making this webinar possible.
Well, I want to thank all of the participants that I invited to be part of this, because it was really wonderful. I learned a lot listening from everybody's presentations too, and so Mark and Vaughn and Bob and Sudarsana and everybody. I really do appreciate everybody's contributions. Gene.